9 called...
You know, we're humans with feelings like everybody else, and we don't all sing about love. You know, I mean, 99.9% of the top 40 in America at any given moment is about love. You know, and we feel that we're a bit more intellectual than that. I think a lot of people can understand, you know, the feeling of isolation and the feeling of frustration that living in the modern world can give you.
Change my way of living.
Now, I've listened to Judas Priest since I was about 11 years old in a group home, about 12 years old, when they sent me away to this first youth center. My brother bought me a Judas Priest album for Christmas, Sad Wings of Destiny. You know, there's some bands that sing about drugs and suicide because that's what the kids like to hear nowadays. That's what they buy. I've, like, put a gun up to my head, but just never, you know. So I just couldn't do it. I just couldn't figure out an easy enough way to do it where I wouldn't have to feel it.
As a family, did you do many activities together?
Yes, we went fishing. We took him to Disneyland when he was younger, Knott's Berry Farm. We went camping. When we lived in Oakland, we went to the zoo quite often up there. We had picnics. We would go to the school carnivals and just normal family activities.
What was your kind of music?
Western, the old 50s. I was used to some of the music my dad used to play, classicals, like the Singing Nun, the Grand Canyon, Around the World in 80 Days.
We got an excellent report from the labs this morning. There's a song, Better By You, Better By Me. You liked that one, didn't you? That has what you'd call pre-conscious stimulation or something on it. We found out what the message is underneath. What's this one? This is Exciter.
Everything you touch is threatened to your face.
This is Better By You.
Sandwich.
That's still
Better By You starts out going Better
By You, better than me. You can say what I only can see.
Thank you. Is the exhalation of breath?
Yes.
Is that a normal part of your singing?
That's the way I've always sung. That's just my style.
Is there some effect that has for the aesthetics of the song?
It's just the works performed, you know, the emotion involved and the feeling that you give out when you're singing it.
Are there subliminal duets on the Better By You, Better Than Me song?
Absolutely not.
I heard the word, do it, the words do it, but I didn't understand in what context or why it was there. I identified approximately 7 of them. It's very difficult because it is at a subliminal level.
Don't
Today's testimony really sums up what this case is all about, which is subliminal or hidden messages in the music of Judas Priest, specifically in the Stained Class album. Now, attorneys came to court today fully armed with computers and high-tech equipment to make their points. There were quite a few spectators in the courtroom, and we asked them if, in fact, they did hear the do it or the so-called subliminal messages on the recordings.
James would do that to me. I mean, he'd insist I sit down and listen to this garbage music by Judas Priest. He would decipher some of the words that I couldn't understand and then get mad because I wouldn't agree with him and say, you don't know what you're talking about, and walk out. He got to where I didn't have any authority. He had no respect for me. He treated me badly.
My parents blame God knows everything for me. You know, they say, oh, it's his music. He's into that music. God, that's messing him all up. And I'm like, hello, this is, you know, let's look back at my past. Let's look at some other things that have happened way back in my life that screwed it up. And they're saying, no, it wasn't us. It wasn't anything like this. It was in the music or it's something else. Parents just do that.
This is what I can't understand, is the stereotyping of people saying that the music's making you do things.
There's a band called Suicidal Tendencies, if you guys heard of Suicidal Tendencies.
Who hasn't?
You know, listen to their forward. Their I mean, their music forward is pretty heavy.
I got suicidal tendencies, but I can't kill myself. I went into a rifle store, bought myself a gun. I pointed it at my head, but I couldn't get the job done. I'm a suicidal failure. I've got to have some help. I got suicidal tendencies, but I can't kill myself. So, I don't know.
There was a time before their suicide pact when he was changing for the better. He had come back to the Lord, as we say, and was reading his Bible. And that's where I get the reference, you know, he was quoting these albums, these songs of scripture, because he would read the Bible and be able to quote scripture to me. And the way he was quoting these lyrics was just like scripture, like he believed every word of it. And that would scare me.
Do you have any worries about the cross-examination? Nothing here in the family background that really hurts us, that really scares us. Cross-examination, Sue Ellen's going to try to dig. She's probably going to rip you a little deeper than she tried to in the deposition.
I will not tell who the biological father is because he was not James's father.
That's the one thing I would object to.
You know, the man was never there to raise him. He didn't want to be there to raise him.
She can't touch you, okay?
Okay.
You've got the same intact family from the beginning. If she says something I don't want her getting into, I'll object, and if I don't want it answered, I'll be jumping up and objecting, okay? Otherwise, answer away.
You characterized your son as obnoxious and a punk, didn't you?
I believe I used those words in the deposition, yes.
And you have been told by school authorities that he had a history of antisocial behavior.
Doesn't antisocial mean you have no friends?
Your son was expelled from Reed for fighting, wasn't he, Mrs. Vance?
Yes, he was.
And he had disciplinary problems in school from the early years, as you testified this morning, with fighting and assaultive behavior.
Every time James got in trouble in school, I was right there. I was a supportive parent. I was there to find out what the details were, to understand what was going on, and to take action where action needed to be taken.
He shot the cat with a dart.
What kind of a dart?
It's a dart gun. Sharp dart.
And did he get in some sort of trouble with the authorities for that?
They came out to the house and took the gun away.
What other brushes with the law did your son have?
He stole some money from an employer. And he got on a bus, him and another boy, and went to Oklahoma.
Why did he go to Oklahoma, if you know?
His natural father is there. He stole a pair of sunglasses from Skaggs one time. Got caught. Everything he ever did, he got caught. Major things. There was nothing. I mean, these things were serious, but they aren't. You know, there's not. You're not really talking like armed robbery or murder, or drugs or. They were minor. I never. When they happened, considered them that important.
My mom, well, we're close, but I can't really talk to her about anything. I don't feel comfortable talking to her about anything. I mean, I haven't had the best family life. I've a lot of things in my family. Ripped off my parents, my brother, like that. But the things I've done have been my fault, not my family's.
Do you think your family coached you along and helped you? Like, say, when I was growing up, my mom never had the heart enough to kick me out of the house, you know, to put me out and show me what it was like. She always said, you know, if you do it again, you know, I'm going to throw you out. You know, I'd steal money from her, you know. The next day she would go down and she'd buy me cigarettes, you know, or she'd give me money for gas to get to work.
I know. What are you doing? Okay.
I tried to be strict on him, not to let him just run wild, but not to be over strict. Because I know, being raised up in a family of 14 children, there was a lot of unnecessary whippings that we got from our father. And I didn't want to do that. When he was 13, he was glassy-eyed. I said, what are you taking? And he says, I'm not taking anything. So I took my belt off. And he says, wait a minute, Dad. He says, I'm too old for you to spank. You're not going to spank me. And I, the first time that I remember, and I think the last time I remember really hitting him with my fist, I just hauled off and hit him, punched him two or three times with my fist. And he told his friend, he says, I'll never smoke another joint as long as I live. And I scared him. Because he did admit after I hit him a couple of times that him and his friend had gotten a marijuana joint from somewhere and went out in the field and smoked it.
Lay. Okay.
They were always after me about blasting my stereo. You know, I'd have a couple friends over and turn up the music a little bit, and then I'd have to argue with them. And I knew down in this house about five times of arguments over music. I mean, it wasn't over drugs, it wasn't over alcohol, it was over the music. So I left home. I kind of had to rely on my friends a lot back then, back when I had good friends.
Hey, Mom, thanks for kicking me out of the house. I gotta be up at night.
That's best. That's
I gotta be up at night. I gotta be up.
I'm gonna be ready.
I gotta be in my house.
You guys all wanna get a party together?
Now all the people around here, if there's something to do and some money to be made.
I could try to work a job and let's go watch TV 5 nights a week and go out on the weekends to the local bar.
Personally, I want to be successful in life and have a good time doing it.
Kick back on.
World peace.
Yeah.
I want a job.
He had one job
sorting mail. He had a job at Burger King. He had a job at Wendy's that he walked out on after the first day. He had a job cleaning office buildings after they were closed. I think he got two or three paychecks and decided he didn't want to do it anymore. He worked for Sierra Sids to clean the trucks until he got acid all over him, and then he decided, well, that was too risky. He just felt like if he didn't want to work a job, he'd quit and go to another one.
Did he develop a certain...
I had a very vivid memory of me walking from my home to school when I was about, I don't know, 11 or 12. And I used to walk from my home on the council estate that I lived in at that time with Mom and Dad. And it was about a mile or 2 mile walk from my home to school. And each day I had to walk past one of these big melting iron metal work factories, you know. And I suddenly had this incredible vivid memory, and I could see, picture it perfectly, and the smell, and you could actually taste it, you know, the all the smoke and all the metal, you could actually taste it as you walked past this building. And I did that back and forth, until I left school at 16.
Every one of us, where we lived, could hear what they used to have, big steam hammers in the Midlands, that they used to, the molten metal used to come out and they used to pound it into shape, these massive steam hammers. And it's the sound that, I mean, I can hear it now, ba-dum, ba-dum.
I don't know what we'd be doing if we hadn't have gone through that type of environment. It's bizarre to think
probably
what
working,
we could have been
working
doing.
Working is still.
Your husband is an alcoholic, is he not?
My husband had a drinking problem and went to AA.
Mr. Vance also has a gambling problem, does he not?
He did have a gambling problem.
And your husband would sometimes gamble away his entire paycheck?
Yes.
Mr. Vance also physically abused you, at least during the earlier years of your marriage. Isn't that true?
That was within the first 2 years, yes.
You wouldn't be surprised if your son told psychiatrist after psychiatrist that he had an unhappy childhood because of the substance abuse problems in the house and other problems.
James made extremes out of some situations.
Big deal. You had a drinking problem at one time. You're no longer drinking. How many people do have drinking problems? How many people do have drug problems? I mean, look at the lawyers and some of the blue-collar workers, they call them office workers, that have drug habits worse than the junkies.
Yeah, but they're not on trial. You know, I want to defend myself. In you as well, a lot of the things that she said wasn't true.
She has to answer to God for that, and I don't want to be in her shoes that day.
You recorded a forward verse, you sang in the forward direction.
That's correct.
And then it was intentionally reversed.
Yes.
And placed on the album.
Yes, quite intentionally.
The admission by Robert Halford that they placed backwards material on albums is a great piece of evidence. They have denied that for 4 years, but under oath he admitted to it, and I think it's the turning point of this case.
Okay. Thanks, Kim. Let me see if I can do
something. I'll tell you something, arid extra dry doesn't work when you're sitting there being grilled.
Life for us at the moment, for perpetual movers that we have been ever since we were born, you know, life is basically standing still at the moment. And while this thing's going on, and it's a bit of frustration. We want to know, we want to get it done and out of the way and move on, you know, carry on with our careers and do what we do naturally.
In a case like this, though, it's always difficult because you've got the image of heavy metal against you. And it's had a lot of bad things thrown at it in the last few years. I know one thing I've learned from this court case, I'd hate to go into court with something to hide. I'd be scared to death.
People don't know what it's like to have to open your whole life after you've had a horrible experience like this. I'm an only child, and I was like a brother. We weren't looking for an easy way out. We honestly thought there was something better.
The lyric line has religious implications that would arouse in anyone in our culture religious associations and feelings. For example, the line reads, "Thy kingdom come, electric ecstasy." Well, "Thy kingdom come" is part, I believe, of the Lord's Prayer, "Thy kingdom come on heaven and earth." And then they end very differently. I think that you have embodied in the phrase itself, in the lyric line, the very conflict, almost, that these young men were struggling with. Now, another example...
Jesus Christ said a lot about the cosmos. Songs like Ethica and Dreamer and Dream Deceiver. Music was just beautiful. We would get power from it, and our emotions would just soar with the music, and they would go up and down, and it was like a drug, like a narcotic. And I mean, it wasn't just this one night, it was always like that.
He made sure I heard the words. And anytime there was a song that came out that was opposite of Christ, I don't remember who came out with the song 666, but he would tell me about it. It was just his way of trying to get back, trying to hurt. He would tell me I was playing church. He'd say, "Oh, you're just putting a show on for people." Well, they might not see me blow up like I would at him, but I wasn't playing at it. He said it to me one time, and I just flat said, "If your mother was playing church and your mother wasn't busy praying for you, you would have died on December 23rd instead of living." And he never challenged me on it again.
We'll just continue to do what we do well, and we're about to start another tour in America, and we look forward to sharing our enjoyment and entertainment with millions of people around the world.
Ever since I was a kid, I always dreamed about being a rock and roll star. Picture myself up there on the stage, you know, either being a singer or the guitar player, you know, looking out on the crowd with all these youths, you know, yelling and screaming at you and going wild.
Personally, I couldn't myself be in the spotlight like that.
That's the whole thing. Because I like to be the center of attention. I like to have power. I like to control things.
I felt real close with Raymond.
Do you know how he felt about you?
He felt real close to me, yes.
When you first married Anita, how old was Raymond?
11.
Any problems on his part of accepting you as an authority figure?
No.
What kind of behaviors might Raymond do that would require you to discipline him?
Maybe cutting school.
Taking the car without permission? Well, you probably wouldn't at that age.
Right.
What would you do?
If I felt one of them had a spanking coming, I would tell them that they had a spanking coming, tell them, you know, they're going to get 3 licks with a belt or 5 or whatever it was, never more than 5. And then I'd have them go find me a belt.
What was the purpose of having them go find the belt?
To let them think about it for a little bit.
How many round clip is it?
6 clip.
6.
And I got this right here, the Spanish Mauser.
All the people that have been talking to, and all those kids out there, and I mean Belknap and Vance and even us, I mean, it sounds like everybody that listens to heavy metal has been abused.
Wrong.
Well, that's what it sounds like. That's what it comes across as.
What it comes across as. But yeah, I was brought up in a perfect family.
My mom's a Sunday school teacher and I'm in the head, but that's besides the point.
Yeah, I went through a lot of problems like the Vance kid did. you know. My parents did everything they could do for me. My mom was totally against drugs and alcohol. My dad was a drug addict and alcoholic. I couldn't be around so-called normal people because of the way I acted. You know, so they sent me off to different psychiatrists, to here, to there. The only thing they could come up with is that I was a hyperactive kid.
Did you know, Mrs. Roberson, that Raymond told Mr. Vance and Mrs. Vance that his ambition in life was to be a professional murderer or hitman?
I didn't know that.
They talked about taking automatic weapons, yes.
And killing numbers of people.
Yes.
And you knew that was abnormal.
It was always after they had been listening to Judas Priest albums in the bedroom.
You knew it was abnormal behavior, didn't you?
Yes.
In cross-examination, defense attorneys blamed the two deaths on a life filled with personal problems.
We had verbal disagreements, yes.
My question was, they made your son, James, angry and confused.
Yes, what child would you?
Phyllis Van said her son worshipped these band members and it's their music that caused.
I don't think you should get so defensive. You got defensive with James, you get defensive with me, you get defensive with the attorneys. When they're not really trying to cut you down.
What attorneys did I get defensive with?
All the attorneys that we've talked to since this case has started, and a lot of different conversations that we've had, you got defensive with the psychologist when we went down there to talk about the problems that we was having with James and with each other.
Because everybody keeps trying to blame everything on me, and it is not me.
That's what I'm talking about. Everybody is down on poor little old me.
You're not being fair to me.
No,
a lot of times James wasn't fair with me, and you know, everybody thinks I'm just supposed to sit there and take it.
You felt that.
What? Tell me what I felt.
When we went to the psychologist or psychiatrist, mm-hmm. when we went to see Tannenbaum, you mm-hmm. felt that James and I both was against you, and you had to defend yourself.
How many sessions did you make it with us to Tannenbaum?
Maybe two. Three at the most.
How come you didn't come back more?
I didn't feel that I was getting anything from it. Every time we go down there, it would end up in an argument.
The backward interpretation, which is, I asked for a peppermint, I asked for her to get one. In forward, stand by for Exciter, salvation is his task. So what we'll hear first is, I asked for a peppermint, I asked for her to get one.
I could literally see his mind clicking and bells and lights going off and thinking, they're right. It was great because when I put the ghetto blaster on the judge's bench, I had to sort of lean round and I was literally a foot away from the judge, you know, and it was an incredible feeling to be that close to the guy. Because when you're in court, you always see this guy in the back with his gown and he's very imposing and very dramatic. And it's amusing because I think of the judge like I guess the fans think of us, because the fans only think of us when they see us on stage, you know. What's he really like close up? Has he got feet and all this business? But he has got feet and he wears nice socks and, you know, pants and stuff. But to be close to him like that was a real, real experience. I got the distinct feeling that the judge was thinking, oh dear, you know, these guys are right, you know. I've been led to believe one thing when, like in all things, there are two sides to every story.
You and Raymond are very close because of all the children of your mother. The two of you have the same father, right?
Yes, we have the same father.
The other children have different fathers, right?
Yes.
Prior to this lawsuit being filed, you'd actually never heard of heavy metal, right?
Yes, I've heard of heavy metal.
But you were not a regular listener to heavy metal on either of the two occasions where you attempted suicide. Were you?
No.
Did you ever see the records from New Frontier?
No, I didn't.
It says New Frontier Treatment Center Evaluation.
Yes.
Indicates the questions asked of James Vance. Length of sobriety in the past 5 years, 2 weeks.
I believe that is incorrect.
You see where the check marks are? Under alcohol, barbiturates, amphetamines, marijuana, and hallucinogens.
I didn't fill out the report.
You see the second question from the bottom? What is your favorite leisure time activity?
Yes.
The answer there is doing drugs, is it not?
Yes, that's the answer there.
It's not fishing or picnicking with the family? I know, and I would refer you to this next to the last page. James talks freely, seems sincere, but is very guarded in his answers. He couldn't think of anything good in his life.
That wasn't written by him, though.
Wasn't that the way your son felt in the summer that preceded the suicide attempt?
He hadn't expressed that to me.
He did tell you life sucks, didn't he?
Yes, he did.
And you knew he was unhappy at home, didn't you?
I don't understand why you're asking me about him being unhappy. What do you mean by unhappy?
My question, Mrs. Vance, is a simple one. Your son, James Vance, was unhappy at home prior to his suicide attempt of December 23rd, 1985, wasn't he?
I don't remember.
There was a dog barking over here. And I yelled at it to shut up. My leg was catching his breath, and he was sitting right here. I could see him, but I couldn't see his eyes. He said he had the gun just clenched up to his throat, and he was talking with the gun just pressed up against his throat. And he said, I sure my life up. There's blood everywhere. And I picked up the shotgun. I had no doubt in my mind. No second thoughts. I knew I was going to shoot myself. I was afraid. I didn't want to die, but I was going to shoot myself. It was like I had no control over it because I didn't want to die. And I shot myself.
He'd had
slam the door. No matter how they try, we couldn't understand. They washed and dressed him, fed him.
One line they keep on patronizing, this world's not fit for living in. I agree with him. Is there some other place to go? Would you like to go some other place besides here?
No.
No, just literally, hear me out. Where there's no hate.
There's never gonna be no hate.
I know, I'm saying, but if there was a place like
but
this.
But if, ain't a word, really. If, see, that's what life's all about. If only I would've did this, if only I would've did that, you know, things would be different, but that ain't, you know, the way life is. You know, that's all past. Nothing can be changed there.
You know, it took me months before I realized that he wasn't going to come home. It took a long time. The baby will say, well, my Ray raised an angel. He's in heaven. The shooting, we don't talk about that. Not, that's not a something that's brought up. And there's no reason to.
Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit.
Help me not pay attention to the externals.
Help me not pay attention to the externals.
But what's going on inside my heart?
What's going on inside my heart?
Fill me afresh.
Fill me afresh.
Fill me new.
Fill me new.
Crowd out everything that is not of you.
Crowd out everything that is not of you.
I yield myself to you today.
I yield myself.
They say we're a highly dysfunctional family. We're a pathological family. James was antisocial. They put all these little tags on there. And the reason I probably don't show any emotions is because they're all lies. Why should I care what they think? I'm not answering to them. I'm answering to God.
The thing I've appreciated about you, Phyllis, is you don't deceive yourself. You've had some problems.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that's the victory of Christ, that even in problems, the Lord has never deserted you. He's never left you. That even when you've had a mistake in your life, you've been able to cry out to him. Receive forgiveness, and go on from there. And that's the strength of your walk.
Well, and I also believe that God knew what he was doing when he made me James's mother.
Well, there's certainly... You know? There's certainly
I don't think it was a fluke.
No, the scripture says that even when we are being put together in our mother's womb, that he has already written all the days of our life.
The dream deceiver by Judas Priest. The figure under the willow tree asked them if they were happy, and they said they didn't know. He took them by the hand, and up the line they fell. We were following the dream deceiver.
Father, James is yours now. Our heart is comforted in that. You've taken his pain away. You've released him into life everlasting. We commend his soul to our Maker in the confident hope of the coming again of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the resurrection of the body from the grave, and the joyous life in the realms of glory. May the Lord bless you and keep you, and make his face to shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious to you and give you peace, both now and evermore. Amen.
Dreamy Saver. Why did you choose that song?
The reason I chose that song is because James Vance quoted it.
Did he?
Yes.
Well, that's the first I've heard about that. Standing by my window, neath the willow tree, heard the, I can't even remember the damn things. Something about finding his peace of mind into the cosmos. Meeting up with somebody that knew all the answers and all these different kinds of solutions. Actually, it's about being took off by some kind of space, like an astral planing kind of thing. I didn't really perceive that as a really meaningful, deep lyric.